We welcome everyone for the evening session, question and answers. Of course, we are 5 minutes earlier. And to start with that, I will first give a summary of the talk delivered in the morning in Sinhala. That was basically about the seventh stanza you find in the Uttara Sutta, the reptile. And it is talking about the thoughts, and when you are translating it or when you are go to the commentary, it says ill thoughts, so bad thoughts. But usually it is the general topic of the thoughts. In Pali it is called vitakka. Technically meaning means adverting the mind, directing the mind. That is the function of the vitakka. It should be translated as thought, but when they, as far as the vitakka is concerned, technically it is translated as applying thoughts. Applying thoughts, at a given moment, there are a number of options for the mind to select. So whatever you select is depending on your likings and dislikings, your rut, your personality, perception and everything, but whatever may be you selected is going to decide the fate, decide the who you are. So therefore the selection is very critical, very important, but unmindful people, those who are not meditating, have no any sense about that. Therefore there is no agenda. It is like a monkey mind, it is jumping from here to there. So the particular function done by the adverting or applying of the happening through the vitakka or the applying thoughts, this is the topic of the morning talk. And usually when we take the eightfold path, the first one is sammadhiti, the correct view, the second one is sammasankappa, that means that thoughts, ill thoughts, sammasankappa means the good thoughts. In that these thoughts are divided into three in traditional, in the canonical way. Inside is known as a thought about sense pleasure, thought about ill will, thought about the hatred. The good side, the counterpart of it is known as sense pleasure is countered by renunciation, and ill is translated by loving kindness. And the hatred, you can say the compassion like. So these are the three, good and the bad. So if the mind is not trained, restrained, naturally it is going to the bad side. That is sense pleasure, ill hatred and the ill will. And therefore knowing that is always natural tendencies to the bad side, you have to understand that. And then as much as try to keep it in the correct side. So in that case, the mere understanding, the characteristics, the function, what is the manifestation of this thought. The supplying thought is very important. That become important as you progress along this insight stages. And otherwise, if you have no any sense, if you have no any value, for this kind of thing, this will be very cumbersome subject to understand it and go into that. But those who are practicing it, ultimately it is really revealing whenever you understand the supplying thoughts. So basic three are recognized as I mentioned, kama vitakka, avyapada vitakka, avihinsa vitakka. That means the sense pleasure, the evil and the hatred. And whenever they are, the Buddha has asked one to take immediate precautions if you are to recognize that your mind is obsessed with sense pleasure, obsessed with the hatred, obsessed with the ill will. Try to put it as much as possible to the renunciation side, that means letting go, and the loving kindness and the compassion. So therefore these three are considered as immediate, it needs, demands immediate attention, and whenever you are going to a concentration, in the sense that getting rid of five hindrances means you are fairly clear of these three, and but still underneath there are some not so virulent, not so infectious germs still appear like appear as thoughts. That means that applying thoughts, but they usually appear in a good phase, appear like a social, political and economically well-being life. Though it has that face value, underneath what is happening is undermining your present moment, putting you into the unpleasant situation. So for these things you must not directly tackle, either to get rid of or to promote. You must understand whenever these virulent thoughts are not there, still the task is not finished. There is yet another layer, and there you have to be careful. You have to be careful, and these thoughts, categorically I can say, ism is appreciating, Buddhism is appreciating, but the Buddha Dhamma, the real core, is not happy with. That is the sharing point. And these 6 points are called Amara Vitakka, that you feel like to have not to get sick and to live completely long without falling into sickness, death and all the kind of thing. Everyone is having that kind of thoughts. So it has been like very friendly and good, but it is a kind of a hallucination. It is impossible. And Janapada Vitakka, you are worried about the political issues happening in other places than here, and what are the other climatic changes happening, cyclones here and there, and all the kind of thing appear like a general climatological, political, economical and other information. So you feel like you are cut off now, and therefore why not to expose little to this kind of thing, like you give a little opening and chance for them, ultimately they come and inundate and you lose the everything. And Janapada Vitakka, Amara Vitakka and Jnata Vitakka, that you consider about well-being of your dear and near ones, and that is also appear like a very compassionate and very altruistic kind of thing. But ultimately, as far as the inside meditator is concerned, he is slightly off the track, he is never been in the present moment. So therefore, though it appear like a very good socially and all the kind of thing, it's undermining you. And anavanyata varasangita vitakka, you feel like in future I will not do any bad thing verbally or physically so that people will find fault with me. I will have a completely pure Samaritan life. And you have an idealistic idea. For the past I was doing this and that mistake, that is why I got the infame and bad blames, and in future I will not do. Oh, Paranuddhaya Varsangita Vitakka, sometimes you feel that I will become enlightened and preach Dhamma for all the people so that everyone will see the Four Noble Truths, and likewise you keep on sharing with though still you are immature, and still it appears like a very compassionate life, but you are not qualified. Being qualified, thinking like that. And another one is, even we are practicing this holistic religious way, there's an undermining idea, I must try to be famous, I must try to get the gain, I must try to give praise, and more than the other person. Each and every person becomes successful in meditation, this is also coming and hovering around you, that fame, gain and glory and kind of thing. So these six, usually, whenever this virulent kind of thoughts are not there, they are always there. So you always sympathize. Always sympathize, because that is the way we are brought up. Ultimately, what happens is, you are losing the present moment. So therefore, whenever they happen, you must not vehemently react to them. You must understand, this is how we are giving the way for this kind of daydreaming, fantasizing and kind of thing. So this is the second layer of thoughts. And the one idea of bringing this up is, each and everyone has either one or the other thing of this for the entertainment. They keep it there and don't consider it as a crime. It is not a crime. It's a nature. Whenever it happens, you just label it. This is appearing as a compassion. This is appearing like a fame and gain. This is appearing like a health. You have a complete healthy life. And to have a sharing with the dear and near one, you label them and keep it in. Ultimately, you will understand it is camouflaging you and perverting you, and ultimately you are losing the present moment. So these nine kind of thoughts are all considered as, on vipassana point of view, bad. But the basic three are the main crux. And now, understanding that advantages and the disadvantages of the ill thoughts and the good thoughts, how can we make use of this? How can we incorporate in our meditation? For example, if you are taking the object of in-breath and out-breath as the meditation, primary object, when you are keep on doing, you hear while the breathing is happening, naturally it is not attractive to our mind, because it won't give any kind of titillation, any stimulation, so therefore mind is always searching about thinking, sounds, pains and all the kind of things. So at the beginning, very difficult for you to clear the path. Over there, mind is going for hearing, seeing, smelling, touching, and keeping them away, and bring the object of meditation, in-breath and out-breath, face-to-face, it's a hell of a fight. And therefore, if you apply the mind for one moment to the in-breath, next moment it's jumping out. And whenever you apply to the out-breath, jumping out. So, don't worry about, while keep on practicing, after a while you may see you can have one or two in-breath and out-breath in a consecutive way under the light of mindfulness. Over there, external things never give up the fight, they will come and distract. Over there only you can apply this thought in terms of labeling, in terms of a naming. That is to say, now the breath is here, a sound is there. And both of them are in the equal strength. Now the mind is hesitant as to which is the one I have to select. Oh, because both of them will try to get the attention. Over there, you must give the priority to the primary object, we'll say inbuilt. If you wish to give the attention, the diversion, aversion, adverting, or steering, what you can do is, you can note the in-breath as it happens, in. And then out-breath happens, out. So that the fighting sound won't get there much of the attention, because you're naming, you're labeling your kind of a stress, kind of a attention. For an example, if you are in a kindergarten level, when you are learning, teaching them A, B, C, D, E, F, G, is like, that is not the kid's main interest. It is for the sake of learning, they have to sit in the front of them, teacher is fighting there, and they are talking here and there, and very difficult to discipline them. So what the teacher do is, she draw a letter A, B, C. And whenever she is keeping the finger or pointer to the A, everyone to shout A. When she is pointing to the B, everyone is shouting B. Then internal talks disappears. Each one gets two sides. One thing is the figure. Second thing is the noise, sound. This is the letter A. sound is A, and the letter B, sound is B, like that alignment happens, instead of other whiteness, other directedness. So these younger classes, as a kindergarten, the naming of it, labeling of it, and calling it by name is strengthening, it is galvanizing. So exactly in the meditation also, if the mind is up to mischiefs, I mean, with the interest of many things, if you wish to give adverting power, directing power, pinpointing, you can just say in-breath, out-breath, in-breath, out-breath, go in, out, in, out. Same thing you can galvanize, strengthen, still if the thoughts are coming. Still if the sounds are coming, you can say in, out, in, out, like, so rubber feels like. And then chances are there, the adverting mind, rather not superficially associating the object, penetrating. And when that noting happens, better chances for you to know the in-breath versus out-breath, in-breath versus the sounds, in-breath versus the noise, in-breath versus the pain. Because you are associating very closely, persistently. So therefore, as and when the knowing happens, noting happens, you get a chance to associate this object. Consequently, you must reinforce, you must, how do you call that, get a chance to know it discreetly. This is not out-breath, this is in-breath. This is not a sound, this is in-breath. This is not a pain, this is in-breath. These are the natural characteristics of the in-breath. These are the intrinsic characteristics of the in-breath versus the out-breath. So therefore, more and more noting happens. If you are skillful, you can get more and more knowing about the particular object. This knowing is in Pali called as vichara, that is, applying thoughts and the discursive thoughts. That is what they have to translate. But maybe more and more your mind adverting to the same thing, you have better chances to see many facets of the same object. That you have to be careful. You have to take the advantage of it. When the mind is with the in-breath, if you are really learning the characteristic of the in-breath versus the out-breath, versus the sounds, versus the pain, that means you are dead sure, you are really associating with the in-breath. The basic chance you get by the adverting of the mind, the applying of the mind. So therefore, more and more you have developed the skill, whenever there are a number of variables, you develop the skill, whatever may be the challenging situation, you know where to divert, where to steer, where to advert the mind. This is how you are slowly trying to get the control about this machine. In other words, we can say our mind is such a versatile machine that only the mistake is no handbook. So now what you do is you put this and that button and try to get at least understand one button related to this. This button is related to that. So like you try to get the channels directed, connections. So adverting is the only game you are doing. By noting one particular thing, you give a highlight. So we'll say that question and answer session. I ask everyone to raise question. Everyone raise hands. Then I have to tell you. You. By labeling, everyone knows now her chance or his chance. Like, the discipline is behind the group. But if I say, okay, come by one, no one knows, no pattern, no method. So this labeling is one of the very efficient tasks recognized namely by Mahasi Sayadaw. But unfortunate enough, up to the today, everyone is criticizing him, it is not found in the canon. So therefore it happened Mahasi Sayadaw to write essay by essay to understand and give the highlight. This is how Manasikara, Manasikara means that in Sinhala, menehi kirima, this is what the Buddha says, so never mind whether it is in the canon or not. You apply and see if the mind is directly going to the object, you get the pragmatically results. Practice and see. So therefore the vitakka in this insight meditation, specifically this pure insight method, via insight method, is very important. By just labeling it, you highlight this. And consecutively labeling the same thing, you get a better chance to know the thing. So therefore, noting and knowing is highly related, just like vitakka and vichara. Yet another parallelism is the concentration and the clear comprehension. Mindfulness and the clear comprehension. Sati sampajaya. Sati is something like vitakka. You give a chance to mind to peace, fall calm and concentrated on one object. Sampajanya is something, it is tasting the object. Get the touch of the object, get the sap of the Dhamma, get the juice of the Dhamma. Each and every object ultimately, your memory is very clear. This is the characteristic of the in-breath, this is the characteristic of the out-breath, these are the characteristics of the pain, these are the characteristics of the sounds. Everything will be very delimited so that everything under your control. And you can see something, you can master them slowly, slowly. So therefore the vitakka, applying tool, is the tool you have. It is like a number of examples I try to give. We say that it's kind of a brass ware. It's in Sri Lanka, it's very common. If you wish to polish it, what you have to do is, you have to get the metal with the full grip, and the next time, with the other hand, you can wipe it. If the first place, if it is not hold tightly, you can't polish it. As far as it is shaking, you can't polish it. So likewise, that to start the polishing business, you have to keep it fixed. Then only the polishing can happen. So, vitakka is something like holding the grip. Vichara is the one go and do the task. And if you are fixing a piece of the iron into a lathe machine, the centering of the iron to the chuck is very important, that is the most skillful. Then only you can start the cutting as you like it. The very fixing is done by vitakka. Upanaka, whenever he is going to say he is, if you are being served with boiled potato, and if you wish to take one with your fork, there's a particular angle and particular way, then only you can penetrate the fork into the piece of the boiled potato. If the angle is wrong, it will never hooked up. When you take the fork back, it will come, won't come. If it is going there, you know the penetrating part. The fork is penetrating into the boiled yam, boiled potato, something like whenever the vitakka is addressing and applying to the in-breath and out-breath, you are the first and foremost person to understand, now my mind is with this. In-breath, out-breath, sound, pain, whatever may be. So you one thing at a time and that done well, clarity starts. And then, once it is hooked up with, once the thing is fixed, the polishing is easier. Or otherwise that, once the lathe machine is fixed, then you can start lathing. So likewise, the understanding the sap of the Dhamma, that means four elements, or whatever may first happen is, the vitakka has to pinpoint what is the object you are addressing, what is the point, what is the object to you are penetrating, adverting. In that sense, the vitakka is very important, and each and every time, whether you know or not, vitakka is working. If it is undisciplined, unrestrained, leading to the ill, and if you take it under control, you can decide whether it is going to be ill or well. So that adverting power you find only in human mind. No other animals, they are thoroughly governed by the instinct. They have no choice. But we have, but we do not use it because we are in a rut. We have our patterns. We have our likings and dislikings. So, ever we select whatever we like it. But the truth has no assurance. It is always lying in your likings. Truth may be on the other side. So therefore, the advertent power indicates you have a kind of maneuvering, manipulating or steering power, and by using this vitakka, your meditation becomes very juicy, very sappy, getting more and more information about the particular object you need. Not motivated by your perception, not motivated by your past memories, not motivated by your liking and disliking. So it's a long process, then only you see things as they are. This is not exactly what I said in the morning, but that is what I feel like translating. Yeah, I mean, it is your character, your traits. And it is due to always it is selecting the same thing. You are in a rut. This mind is working in the rut. But you never make use this ability to advert. Adverting ability, you never make use it. Because you hesitant to have a restraining kind of. As far as no restraining, it is in a rut. While restraining, it appears like narrowing. But what happens is, expanding the scope. Because you are taking the vitakka under your control, little by little. So now we are going to go to the questions. First in English, and there seems to be several explanations of the method of walking meditation. So could you please explain to us, Ekar, how the interplay of the four elements influence the process of walking? The understanding of the four elements, namely the earth element, the water element, air element and the heat element, is an advanced level of whatever may be the meditation. Either in Anapanasati or in walking meditation, it is to say the element is the middle or transitional place from the convention to the absolutes. Whenever the convention changing into the absolute, it has to go through the elements. If you end of the conventional understanding is the element, the beginning of absolute is the elements. Whenever you go to the element, you are in a transitional period, you are in a changeover. So therefore elements, ways to explain it, for the moment I would say, element, before you come up with the elements, your knowledge is completely conventional. It is a convenient. But after you thoroughly understand the elements, but you open the door and go to the absolute, and once you understood the elements, internal, external, no difference. You and me, no difference, so boundaries cut off. And then no mind become universal consciousness rather than individual consciousness. As far as the mind associating this convention, we have our personal individual consciousness, our liking, our culture, our bringing up, our sex, everything. But one, whenever mind become mindful and understand the in-breath, out-breath in terms of element, you are opening a door to see the absolutes. And then you can understand how the others see it, what it was yesterday, what will be the tomorrow, and it is going for the beyond the dimension of time and space. So therefore element is a very transitional period, so adopting it to that is not religious, it's a kind of a scientific thing, but misunderstanding can happen if you don't have the faith and other kind of faculty. So therefore, better to have spiritual and how do you call this, religious kind of atmosphere. So your smooth transition from the convention to the elements and from elements to the absolutes, gradual process can happen. So four elements have very, very unique features. It is completely scientific. Now all the scientists find these qualities and they are mystics also come into being. Scientists call it is mystic, we call it is religious, we call it spirituality. When you are moving, walking, we'll say you are keeping the right leg. And then you feel it, we'll say for example, touch. To touch to happen, two different things has to come together. Equal thing come together is not recognized in the world as touching. That you have to understand. We don't feel equal two things moving. Only two things has to touch, different thing has to come into contact, that is what we technically call as touch. That touch will be heat and the cold can be touch. Moving thing can be touched with a stable thing. Liquid thing can be touched with a hard thing. All the kind of things. So wherever our mind, our consciousness recognize touch, it is never single surface, two things. But we usually don't read two. We are happy with one. We say, I feel hard. But under the hardness never exists in the world without the softness. Darkness cannot exist in the world without the lightness. Behind the light backward. So everything has this game, the bipolar system, two sides have each coin. And we see only one side. So never mind. You start with hardness. And then you feel that moving nature, stable nature, curvy nature, flat nature, all the kind of things. When you keep on accumulating information without judgmental, slowly, slowly you will understand there are many, many shapes and many, many facets. Each step you keep, sometimes you feel the heat and cold, sometimes the ruggedness of the ground and the leg is flat, sometimes earth is hard and the leg is soft, sometimes leg is hard and the earth is soft. So different kind of things we learn with the conventional words. But when you keep on practicing, keep on going, we are coming under this earth element, water element like only four. And when you take the earth element, we'll say heat element, it's a combination of two completely opposite phenomena, heat and cold. Heat element means not the heat, it is the combination of heat and the cold. In the conventional world, they are contradicted. But they can't live without these two. Just like the husband and the wife, always fighting. But when you go out, go hand in hand in the society, or we are very, exactly the same game in the each other. Opposites are living together, they always marry. But at home fighting, outside living together. So sometimes we see at home element, sometimes we see the social side. So when you go there, opposites are living such in harmony, unbelievable. Heat and the cold living together as the heat element, fluidity and cohesiveness live together as a water element, moving nature and the holding nature living as the air element, hardness and softness living as the earth element. But each and every time we see earth element, we have a notion hardness is better than softness, or softness is better than hardness. That is the one we impose upon them, due to our notion, due to our perception. When you keep on observing, you can see morning time, heat is pleasurable, cold is not happy. But then in the midday, heat is uncomfortable, cold is good. Again to the evening, again the heat is good, cold is bad. The morning to evening, our impression changes, but the heat can never understand that particular person gave me a credit or that particular person regarding me. They will look at and see, what a fool is. Because at time it is appreciating, at time not. That is all due to our perception. So therefore, more and more you see them, the heat and cold have no any sense of good and bad. It has no any good sense about the just and unjust. They are just mere element. Each and every time we meet them, we put a label. We put a value system. And value system is the one who go to the memory. Not the real nature. Real nature never goes there because it is not changing, it is not deteriorating us, it is not make us interest. So, after long observation also understand, elements are mere elements. Each and every time we see elements, we put a value judgment, which is the grading. And that grading is going to the memory. More and more you go there, you will understand, these things are really teaching us there. Elements are teaching, but we never learn. Elements are so common, so obvious, but each and every time we confront it, we see them through the tinted glasses. The glass is my liking, my disliking. And one example is, you know, each and every religion has a hell and a heaven. Each religion has a hell and a heaven. If you go and ask the hell and the heaven from the Tibet, it is the coldest country, they will say hell is very cold. If you do a wrong thing, you will be destined to the Sitanarki. Go to the hell, it's full of cold. And if you do a good thing, you will be taken to the very warm place. But if you go and see the Quran, and which is written in the deserts, they will say, if you have done the wrong thing, you will be put in the heavy heat. You will be fried, finished. And if you have done a good thing, you will be evergreen, flowing water, nice garden. So therefore, good thing in the Tibetan, bad thing in the bad timing. Good result of the Tibet is bad thing in the desert. So these two groups completely believe in it. But if you go a little beyond and see how they have given the value system, the heat and the cold, conditioned by their own culture, their own atmosphere, we also say, as the life goes, as the day passes, as the beginning, the middle and end passes, we are completely see things as we like. As a wish. But the elements have no that kind of a camouflage. They are the real elements. So more and more you are going to observe, you will see each and every time you feel heat, cold, you see through your tinted glasses. So in walking meditation, you can feel the hardness. You can feel the flatness. You can feel the cold. You can feel the moving nature. You can feel the stability. All these are no magic, no religion, there's no spirituality. But the spirituality says, each and every time you feel the flatness, you have a value judgment, practice good, rough is bad, or rough is good. And now HSB and bank, they have put an advertisement, the old model and the novel, the new fashion, all is now changed, new, very nice terms they are using. The traditional one now become a modern. The modern one now will become a tradition. They are using exactly the way for the last 30-40 years how the value judgment changes. The utility, the aesthetic. This is what you boil down when you go to the element, that is what happens. And the elements get another character available. Elements never appear single. Always it's a complex. Billions at a time. Even though it's within a very limited capacity, 1001 element manifest, never these two fighting each other. Billions are in the end of one, just like if you see a TV screen without the program, you see the dots. That you can see billions of dots, but have you ever seen dots are fighting each other? Never. Each and every dot has a beginning, middle and end, individually, intrinsically for that dot. The elements are also the same. At a time you can see the heat, it has its own beginning, its middle, its disappearing. And the same point the coldness can come. Very same point, next moment, the coldness can come. They are not answering, they are not fine shy. We feel, how can the cold can transfer into the heat? Heat can go into the shyness, we can't believe it. But the elements are complete pure Dhamma, pure phenomena. Billions and billions are there, never fighting. Each and everyone has its own beginning, its own middle, its own ending. So you, whenever you're going to see the phenomena, choicelessly, get a distance and see someone else like, you see each and every screen, always it's a combination. Not a single factor, not a single variable, thousand and one variables. But out of this all, one thing is more prominent, more conspicuous, more attractive. That is due to my liking and disliking. They have no such a prompting that I am beautiful, I am ugly. They are not jumping. We see only this one because of our value judgment. After long observation, you will understand if you take the sum total, elements have never changed from the evening to the morning. Morning to the evening, but our value judgment ever changes. So we have to show it again and again to see how much we are adding, we are camouflaging, we are editing, fabricating these elements. Therefore, once you see elements as elements, you can understand the heat, cold, stiffness, tension as it. For example, when you observe the pain, something related to walking also, is you feel like heat, burning pain. You feel that the pain is just like a burning, and you can understand this indicate the heat element, and one particular bubble is very hot, other side found no. So we feel uncomfortable in the heat element. So if you understand this pain as a heat and try to observe it, getting a distance from the pain and observe it, you see it is not all the way keeping there. It bubbles either changing and changing into the cold bubbles, and sometimes a patch, it's sometimes single. Many, 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 many things are there. It is like something to be exploring rather than reacting and getting rid of the pain. So whenever the pain becomes in terms of elements, it becomes a laboratory. Your body is a laboratory, here and there it comes and manifests heat, cold, stiffness, tension, movements. And if you observe it, you have to get a distance from yourself. Observe it as an alien, someone else. When you are walking, after 30-40 minutes, you feel like a puppet. The walking happens. Over there, if you see, how do you understand the left leg versus stout leg? So only through the language of elements. Never, otherwise there is no matter. You feel heat, stiffness, the combination changing, heat, stiffness, tension, movements, cold, roughness, everything. But always our mind trying to give a label or painting, seeing through the glasses, and then only we tell them right, left. But if you keep on practicing, ultimately you will get the feeling. Then you can't discriminate whether right or left, but you are completely aware of it. When that happens, the element becomes general element, your tagging, your labeling becomes disappears. That sometimes will dramatically happen in breath. At the beginning you can see the difference between the in-breath and out-breath. When they become calm down, you understand the breathing happens, but you can't discriminate. That is because the convention has dwindled off, it has come to the elemental level, mind gets confused. It can't make it out. Ultimately, mind but say, what the mind say, it complain, go home and go to the office and complain, no breath. But that is not what happened. Happened is the discrimination disappears, everything boils down to the same thing, either a movement or a jerk or vibration. So you say there are no characteristic of in-breath. But definitely you are not dying. You are living, breath is taking place. But what happens is individual characteristic disappears, the common character rises. Whenever the common character rises, the choice, the selection drops. It has no place to hook. That is why if you are observing one thing for a long time, its individual character disappears, ultimately the common character rises. The other thing appears boring. The other thing appears monotonous. The other thing appears fearful-like. No tasty, no crispy, no juicy, no sappy. So you instead go for your labels and yet another object. So therefore, whenever the elements happen, it is not that no prominency, but our mind reject that. Mind do not like elements because it likes labels. It likes something discriminate, characteristic, rather than the elements. So therefore, once you recognize, appreciate the element, you become qualified to go into absolutes. There you see the, it is not whether you or he, past or the future, things are the thing. It becomes go to the normal datum line. There is no fluctuations there. And there the basic thing is, as far as the fluctuations are there, attraction is there. As far as no fluctuation, attraction reduces. That is why the Buddha says, virajyati vimuchyati. Virajyati become, it appears like bleached. So we take a very colorful cloth and put the bleaching powder. Ultimately, every color appears to be pale white. The pattern disappears. Exactly any object, if you observe long, it becomes bleached. That is called virajyati, ranjane, or attractiveness disappears. But we consider it as something of our mistake. We think anabana or breath is unattractive. Or it becomes conspicuous, unprominent. So therefore we go for new things. We search for some other thing. Ultimately you made up everything. You cut off the continuity. So you have to understand whenever the element going to happen, that will mature. That you have the double fold concentration. Rather double for mindfulness and observe it, the same combination till the whole the metamorphosis finished, whole evolution finished. Then understanding one thing, any object, it gives a complete panoramic view. But we are so untrained, almost half we change object. Again, we go back to the original, because original is a lot of individual characteristics, colorful, dramatic, eventful, so you go back. More and more you mature, but that means you are waiting maturely, be mindful, try to see this border, try to see this pale color, try to see this monotonous thing, try to see this undisinteresting. That is why you invite the elements to happen. And it is opening door to the absolute. So it is walking meditation happen more dramatically than sitting meditation. Because it's a lot of dramatic actions are there. So if you can cope up with them, sounds, hearing, touching, wind blows, and intentional work, double fold energy, so picture is more dramatic. So therefore many people catches these elements in walking meditation than in sitting. theoretical kind of people can understand from the sitting meditation, practical people understand it more in pragmatic way in walking meditation. Should the meditator become aware and concentrate on the actions of the four elements to produce walking? No. It says whenever these elements happen, you must not try to label them. You must not try to pinpoint one. What you have to do is let it happen undisturbed. More and more things to happen. Because at the beginning you see only the prominent things. But the whole picture, when you come to happen, you understand your mind has to be completely, mobilized to see the elements. If you are selecting, nobling and labeling kind of thing, you are going to concentrate, the mind can't see the whole panorama. So therefore, let it happen. It is like when you are boiling milk, when the water, the fire going to start, you see here and there bubbles. And ultimately, you have to let it completely overflow and go overflow the pot. Then only you can say it is really boiling. Exactly that this thing going to boil. In the walking meditation, in the sitting, you feel like the whole body as a boiling pot of milk or boiling pot of ice. Or otherwise you see water, the rain falls onto a water surface. Everywhere the drop and hit, bubbles come. Or otherwise if you put mustard seed onto a hot pan, everywhere it is start to pop up. Something like that you feel, at the beginning you see here and there dots, here and there bubbles are coming. Don't try to chase them behind. Don't try to pinpoint them. Maximize it. Energize it. Give more and more fire. Ultimately everything is going to boil, but the fear can appear. What will happen and where can I go? And because everything where you see, it is bubbling up, popping up. But it's a kind of a massaging, the whole body massaging. If you're brave enough to give it, you get a whole body exercise. It's a healing process in realistic. But many those who have the perception of permanency, they can't tolerate this impermanence. So they destroy, destruct this trend. You have to go prepared. Whenever boiling happens, sacrifice yourself, let it happen. Full up, give more and more full, not only the right element, not the heat element, cold element light. You are not the convention, left, right, left, right. But you are not going to understand this is heat, this is cold, this is, no. Element wise you are not naughty, you just not the convention.
This applies to sitting meditation
too, this boiling. Yeah, that is why that the usually it is to take place, sometimes 1 hour is not enough. But the seasoned yogis can come up by 15-20 minutes and then start the boiling. With the basic preliminary preparation of the mindfulness and the concentration usually take 35-40 minutes. And then only the vibration start. And there also you are the very person destroying. You feel uncertainty, you feel unfamiliar, you feel something wrong, you think, you go to the teacher and your telephone call, something happened, what should I do? Ultimately, what happens is you cut off the train. To so much you love the whole body not to disturb, it must be completely in the comfort till go to the Nibbana. So ultimately, you are the very person blocking this. That is the smartness of your self-ego. Smartness of this sakkayiti, the egocentric idea. So therefore you have to be like a girl guide or boy scout. That's under risk taken. Then only the boiling keep on going. So therefore I say you have to be a male. Running a risk. So many females are not happy telling that at the Dhatu Manasikara level you are changing your sex. If you are really Dhatu Manasikara, After 2-3 times, your femaleness will be disappeared. You will be bold and flashing. Risk lover. Oh, there are some other terms. In the business also, only the risk lovers are winning. Other people are never invest the money. They may share and all the time, but the person, he knows the business, he put the money. Come, go, Chicago. So here also, it's a kind of a game. It's a kind of a, how to call this, gambling. You have to gamble with your likings and dislikes. You have to gamble with your body. You have to gamble with your personality. Little by little, you develop the threshold value. Never mind. Water is little trouble water. Still, you know how to say. So, Dhatumaisakari said, I would say, only the personality changes. Only the change, liking and disliking going to change only after Dhatumaisakari. Till that, you are the same old rat. Same old cock. Whatever meditation you do, never you will be changed. You are not taking a risk. That means you don't have faith. You don't have energy. You don't have mindfulness. If you develop more and more, you feel like going there. For beginners take usually more than 1 hour to get this momentum. And you see, when a plane is running the runway, it develops the speed. And just before it is airborne, the whole plane is in the vibration. Therefore, everyone has to with the tight pills, even the cabin crew. Otherwise, it is taking the momentum from the solid earth to the air. It's a transition. So, pilot is telling, be prepared. Prepare the cabin for takeoff. Everyone has to be so. Therefore, all your seizure must be intact. It's virtues. Your mental preparation must be intact. Yesterday, you must understand, I came to this point and I gave it up. Today, I will go there. Then the convention run ultimately go into the soul, into the absolutes, and now airborne. And after become airborne, you can't go to the toilet. Never mind, the bell sign will be removed. But when you are going, taken off, each and every day, each and every setting, you have to be tightened belts. Be prepared for that. It happened when everything vibrate. And you feel like goosebumps, some kind of a feeling. Some kind of a, what do you call it, kilipolano? Goosebumps? You feel it. I mean, whatever may be, how much flights you have taken, but when it's happening, it's there. So you know now, no more in the convention, now I am taken up to the airport. So Dhatumansitara is the point where the shape of the thing is changing. Engine is running at the maximum speed, and there's no way if you have to land, it's a crash landing, because you are at the end of the runway. No chance. Most of the accidents are happening in the planes in that level. So that is why people are always landing again, thinking better not to take a risk to go to the airborne, better to be with the Mother Earth than ever earthbound. And Dhatumaisakari is such a risk, that is why I say, try to be a man. Take a risk. Definitely, definitely, it has 1001 facets. And understanding heat and cold is the Montessori level. Because heat, everything boiling. Everything heat, they are cold, they are stiffness, they are tension, they are movement, they are 1001. Just like the water raining on the water surface, meaning you can't recognize them in the thousands. But you never mind. The soul is well. As it comes, don't try to put the theory behind, theory forward. It comes, and when you give the frictionless approach to develop, to get the momentum, to mobilize it, it gets the momentum. And ultimately you can't understand this and that, you know something happened. Everything boiling. And you have to just give the chance to happen it. And ultimately after that you will complete relaxation, whole body massage. Whole body appears completely renewed, rejuvenated. all your diseases will be again restarted. So if you can do it, the maximum compassion, maximum well-being to yourself. Our mind is pulling backward, not to run a risk. So slowly, slowly you have to put up the threshold value and ultimately you success of your meditation decided by this event. If it can, every sitting you can get it, you are definitely sure you are going to the new area, unknown area. Meditation is go deep and deep. If you are stopping at short of that, that means your friction. You are always putting the brake. You do not like to run a risk. You do not like to go and intrude into this unknown. So that is why I call Gyanukam, the femaleness. So they are not happy with me when I am telling. I mean, you have to run a risk, and that's true. After doing, you understand such a wonderful thing. After happening such a thing, you are completely ready to any kind of a risk. So that is why this Dasman Karika is a vast subject. PT. That PT is the result of Dasman Karika. If you allow the Dasman Karika to do frictionlessly, full-fledged, you are in utter PT. I mean, you can't explain it. It is inalienable, unalloyed. It's by itself, it's completely content. You don't feel like forking your fingers, let go. That is the culmination of Dhatu Manishkara. Yeah, the mobilization of Dhatu Manishkara is a proximate factor for the PT to arise. Whenever mobilization happens, invariably it is leading to the PT. So you understand, if you are not blocking, this is the natural way the meditation happens and you end up with the PT, and it is not the Nibbana, it is not the culmination, but you get a kind of a immunity, kind of a faith upon your practice. Faith upon, huh? Yeah, kind of a sign, now you are on the way. Till that all the others are not substantial, other experiences are not substantial for you to be happy. But there onward you understand, this is how each and every yogi keep on this practice with so much of friction, so much of burden, so much of difficulties, keep on, because that PT is never related with the material. It is immaterial kind of pleasure. All the pleasure we have so far experienced is something related to the material. Visual objects, sounds, smells, taste, comfort, luxury. But these are completely independent, and you will understand this is not only the external sources of the sound, the visual object, taste, but it is completely independent of the eye, independent of the ear, nose, tongue, body, mind. It's a kind of inhuman or unhuman, because the human world never talk about it. It is talking only about the material kind of thing, and this luxury, scientific, technological, everything is talking about that. But you can't compare it when you compare with this kind of a PT, because it's free of charge. And therefore, it is once you go there, you get addicted. You never mind these all the visual objects, never mind these all the music become a noise, all the visual objects become an irritant, all the smells become like a rubbing and brushing your nose, all the taste becomes such a gross when compared to that immaterial pleasure. So when someone is telling like that, people say they are talking about magic, it is not possible in this life, how can this go there, because they know only that material pressure. They know only the worldly pressure. So Buddha says it is the people, those who are with one eye blind, they can see but not the depth. They can see 3D. Only the both the eyes, that means material pressure and immaterial pressure, that particular person can see the depth. Other people will also see kind of a pleasure, but it is a beastly kind of pleasure. This is exclusively human. So it, we can say unhuman. Because many are not reaching that and they still claim they are happy, they are rich and they are all the kind of thing. But the Buddha, he is half smiling, he is looking at us sarcastically. That is why he is not smiling, because he also was in the same trap for a long time. Now he's look at these bloody fellows are telling they are poor, they are happy, they are rich and they know that what they know. They don't see the depth, but still they are telling, I achieved, I got it and all the kind of thing. But it is just a dream. The moment you get up, you understand these are just watercolor picture. When the water falls, everything washed off. No persistence. But this immaterial one, more persistent and more independent of the internal object and the sense faculties, and it is, there is no fighting. Therefore, very easily you can understand this immaterial pleasure you get by a walkover. No rivalry part. All the visual, everything you have a rivalry. Competition, supply and demand. But this one, unreserved, huge source, no one go there, unfortunately. It never ending source. So that is why the Buddha says, if you compassionate, if you have well-being to yourself, please open this door and show it, so this mind will not go for this rat race. Fighting with this, all the people fighting for the visual objects and sounds and, oh, then let them entertain it, because that's the only thing they have. Poor fellows. He said, you can mind your own business. Go to this pleasure. Go to this Dhatumanasikara. Get your massage. Rejuvenate yourself. Both the sides you have. Jhanik, oh, that means concentrated samatha. Oh, vipassana. Both they have. At the vipassana level, it is happy like a upakkilesa. Upakkilesa, that vipassana person understand that as a trap. Jhana person understand as a good thing. That is the only difference. You understand?
Yes.
So vipassana person, that's a very nice the study they have done. I am sorry that I had that cassette. I knew it is valuable, somehow then I lost it. It's done by Daniel Brown, he is working in Boston. And he is giving a talk to the general, but don't misunderstand me that I am not going to highlight Buddhism against the other religions. And his talk was telling, understanding this immaterial pleasure and the material pleasure, he wanted to test it, people with different denominations. When they have announced anyone, intellectual people, volunteering for this experiment, young girls and the boy from the Hinduistic, Sikh, Muslim, Catholic, Buddhist, all the kind of people. And they are given a very particular technique to keep the mind in one object. That is, not religion, not spiritual, anapano, whatever. They are after keeping that, everyone experiences it because they are so to the point they can understand it and go there. And after experiencing this, everyone has asked their comments. And their volunteering was raw material, endowment for the researcher. But different religious people say he is a Muslim. And he came to the experiment and he underwent and he experienced this kind of a rapture, this kind of a dhatumanasikara, everything is coming. And he was writing, he says, this is what we find in the Quran, this is what the ultimate energy, the creator, and we are taught we can't see it unto the death. But I understand, if you are practicing, that can happen, that is what the Muhammad observed in the cave. And I went there, thank you very much for selecting me for the research. I never thought this is something experienceable in this world. So I went to the almost close to the God. And this is immaterial, this is inhuman, It's a kind of a thing. Enormous source. There's no thing over there, no good, bad, no correct and wrong. It's a unique. It's a basic energy. Everything coming out of that, that is what we call. And when you go to Christianity, this is the creator God, this is the basic energy. And out of that only everything happens. So I, due to this method, I meet, I feel it, and I am the happiest person in the world. Muslim Hindu person also say, this is what we depicted in our book as Brahman, Brahma element. So we reach it. And then the Sheikh in their way. And only the Buddhist person has told, this is the, what the Buddha has mentioned to be careful. This is upakesa. This is that. Our vipassana start from this. If you get trapped into that, no go. You have to understand this is a byproduct of concentration. So therefore, I thank you, but I am sorry, I have no time, I have to go and practice.
Is there the idea that when my experience is this, when it ends, a person feels they've done something wrong, that they've done something wrong and they haven't actually done it wrong?
No.
It's just the condition to end it.
So that is why in the jnana, I mean, inside knowledge is from the immature udayabhijnana to the mature udayabhijnana. If the immature rising and passing knowledge is the mature the rising and passing knowledge, knowledge is marked by these 10 defilements. This is upakkilesa. Obhasa, piti, jnana, pasaddi, upekka. All things you expect is coming in abundance. And if you are going to appreciate it, you get that. You must be in the primary object. At the midst of all the gains, all the endowments, you must not get moved by the light, must not get moved by the piti, pasaddi, the upekka, the equanimity, the energy, mindfulness, everything can be abandoned. You must understand this trap. You must search and see, can I see the primary object? If you can see the primary object, you are again back on the track. Otherwise we are on the track. So therefore the Buddha, he has given there, he says, this is the point you feel like achievement, but it is not an achievement if you do not now have the correct perspective, the correct middle path understanding. So what is happening in America is, sorry to say, they all trap at that. So they are using meditation for healing. They are using meditation for curing, using meditation to increase the memory power, using meditation to increase the this and that. That means they are in the same whirlpool but in a higher level. So Munindraji and other people, those who introduced meditation to the West, is I am very sorry, Western people are always thinking about the sense pleasure. So they put this also to increase the sense pleasure. But the Buddha's idea is not that. This is just a trap to see whether you are genuinely seeking for Nibbana. If you are seeking Nibbana, you have to go to the primary object. Despite of all these kinds, no, you are not antagonizing them. You understand good, but to keep the trap quick, you have to seek the primary object. So therefore, that is why it says, Dhatu Manchakari says, such a challenge, such a kind of a skill. You don't know which way it is going to. Always keep the primary object in view with. And the primary object is by that time very subtle, unperceivable. The shapes and manners are different. But even then you must have the benchmark. Whether to see whether it's a hallucination or trap or kind of thing. Always refer back to the primary object, that indicates you are back on the correct base.
You become
get attracted, magnetized. If you get magnetized, and the magnetism is the 10th upakkilesa, nikanti, you get attracted, you feel, I am the person, earn it, and I achieved, and many people mention it, they are idiots, they can't come up with that, I am the person, I got light, I got to this, blah, 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 and ultimately, he or she becomes worse than the other person who has not received. Because he put it to boost up its own energy, ego. Oh, I achieved life. No. The Dhamma, the related principles of cause and effect come, this is happening. It's not you. It's a Dhammata. It's a universal law. If the other factors are there, this structure comes, this boiling happened, this everything happened, you can't claim it. Of course you are, you can witness it. That is the point you have to be, this is not me, this is not mine, this is not my soul. That is why you, despite everything, you still select the primary object to take the alignment, take the orientation. That is called benchmark. Primary object over there is a helpful, really helpful, just like a navigator, to see where are you, to see the either destiny or starting point. If you are going to call this real home, still I am not happy. This indicates now I am at the Dhatu Manasikara level, I am in between the absolute truth and the conventional. So there I have to navigate very carefully to keep the head forward to the absolute. But again you have to come here and go there, come here and go there. After monitoring, after mastering, you know this transitional period. Transitional period is the rejuvenating, recuperating, brushing again. Therefore each time you go there, you appreciate the Buddha, you appreciate Dhamma, you appreciate your own Sila, everything. And you must understand this is not the destiny. It's a good sign if you have strategically select a good path. Equally to your bad, if you are going to assume it. Therefore, whole meditation is called unassuming. This is not me, the Dhamma Tha, change reaction.
Thank you. When you talk about Dhamma
Tha,
you have the strong evidence for the true characteristics. All of them, is that
all there? It is a theoretical way. And then you can put into your normal thinking, can whole world explain to Dhatu Manasikara, that is called Chintamaya way, or that is deductive way. And then when you are practicing, it's a completely different thing. You see the hardness, you see. And there, the as it happens, never you divert, now you direct. Never you have perceived idea, premeditated idea. Premeditated idea, I always look down. I think it's a condition.
See it in
a natural way. It is never happened in a sequential order. It happened in an ad hoc way. Impromptu way. Improvised way. So that is how you have to be a girl guide or a boy scout. Improvisation. Anything happen, you must understand. This is just a part and parcel of the game. If I am to see the whole game, let it happen naturally. That is the more intrinsic nature of the insight meditation. Insight meditation, no manipulating, no monitoring, no introducing anything, just unwinding process. So therefore that to understand, give a lecture and talk about, you must understand Dhapati Vidhatu have six characters, Tejo Dhatu two characters, one. It's good. But when you are practicing in the, how do you call it, experience is completely open mind. Get rid of all the theories, let the boiling pot to boil. If so, how and at what point should it be done during the process of organizing? So this question never happens. How and where to happen, no one knows. If it happens, they can be an advantage and go into the Dhatu Manasikara. So here is no gear to put into the walking meditation of Dhatu Manasikara to the absolute truth, there is no such things. It is a natural process. When the natural process happens, you are just interpreting as it happens. Otherwise, if you say that I have done 3 months of meditation, now I have to go to Dhatu Manasikara, and then I have to go to this and that, that means that you are going to put this whole beautiful thing into the square thing. And you have to suffer. You have to suffer because let it happen unhindered. and frictionless way. Let it happen, don't fork your, don't go select with your likings and disliking. You won't say that they achieved or it's a failure. When it happens, you just let it happen. Yes. And if it is leave frictionless, it is gathered the momentum. If you are working, forking fingers and you go to manipulate only, then it will never grow. It growth is completely kind of hindering or disturbances are there. Just like a fetus when it is growing, it must go without manipulating. Whatever the manipulation you are going to do, you can't imagine the complication going to happen. So let it happen. Maybe it's a boy, your girl, never mind. Walking fingers is called that eating sour mangoes. You don't allow it to ripen by itself, you fumigate it and eat it. And then you will never get the taste of mango. So let it go ripen the fruit in the tree. In Sinhala we call Ale Eranakang in the Gulan, Dambanakang in the bag. I don't know how to put it in English, sorry. You can wait till the yam is coming up to the maturity, but till boiling you can't resist. You just eat half boiled. So your digestion will be upset. Pardon me?
Diarrhea.
Diarrhea, purging, and ultimately ending up with all the problems. The next English question, it is said that Sakkayaditti is eradicated with the attainment of Sotapatti. If the ego concept, complete absent of self, is not present, why is it that other fetters, kamaraga, lust and patika remains? So this is a kind of a misunderstanding of the basic principle this question comes. If the Sakkayaditti or the egocentric idea is removed at the very first Magganyana, how that other the definement remains, because this is the state, this is the sustaining base, if that is not there, how that is remains right? So this is the mistake of our linear education. We always try to attribute one to one. In the world, reality, nothing one cause going to give one result. Everything always, many causes are going to give many results. But when you are teaching, you teach with the most prominent cause and prominent effect. So everyone understands, by understanding this, everything finished. No, this is our bondage to the samsara, not only to the ditti, tapasya, mana, tanha. That means conceit and desire. There are three strands. Even if you cut off the ditti level, the views, the tanha and mana is remaining. So they linger off. So therefore, this is a very good achievement, weakening of your enemies, but that does not indicate the finishing. So therefore, in the warfare, first you attack, and once you gain the ground, you have to establish the power in the second process, before going to the next attack. So this is the warfare. When you attack and gain the enemy's area, you stop the war and check it all the area you have already gained, because there may be landmines and all the kinds of one that is covered, only you go to the next. Keep on attacking means you are losing your ground, because there may be something hidden and they will come from the both sides then and you will be finished. So therefore, seasoning is very important. After the Sakkayaditti removed, you experience it, how the life with the ditti and mana, or conceit and the desire. Still there is a huge fight you have to fight, but you are better off now. So therefore one can't say that everything is hanging on the same single Sakkayaditti and by cutting off everything is dropping. No, there are many, many strands. So in our linear relationship we are pathetically try to understand one-to-one relationship. This is called linear education, but the Dhamma working in the matrix. This is a huge complicated thing, three dimensions. That is why the Buddha says that the maximum he is explaining different combinations are fighting each other with these different mudras. We our mind is such a condition by this education system. We see only the linear relationship. That is the mistake or weakness in theory understanding. But it is good as far as you can use it, as far as you know the limitation of theory understanding. Then it can be put in the positive way. So only answer is the sansaric bondage or fetters or hooks are not single fold. Many, many are there, one by cutting by that, you weaken proportionately, but the others are there. So you have to keep on cutting like that.
So what exactly is weakness actually? Self-consciousness, ego, born, self. It's normal,
No.
What's new?
All these have fetters in terms of view, in terms of conceit, in terms of desire. The fetters related to the views is cut off. All the other two things are available. Therefore, the materiality, you have the view kind of a connection, link, hook, fetter, a desire point of view. Conceit point of view. Your very body, you consider this as mine, it is not yours, and kind of a view kind of. Other thing, mine is beautiful, I am young, and all the kind of the desire. And the conceit, comparing with the others. Even if you cut out the views, two other things are available. So you have to keep on practicing. Sakkaya Ditti is talking about Ditti. Tanna Mana Ditti at least. This is also not the ultimate, this is the way to teach you basically three. There are 1,500 definements in total list in the theoretical way. But then basically they are arrowhead formation at the tip you three, at least three. Tanna Mana Ditti. So in the sense, we have to say, but theoretically we can't actually practice. Theoretically we can communicate little, but by practicing only, you understand it is not a single pole fight. So enemies are in the many battalions. Even if you win one battalion, there are others almost there. But your morale increases, so therefore you can boost up your battalion and attack the others also. But you must not throw parties and go for champagne by telling that by battalion, we can only one battalion.